You are listening to Transformation at Work, your one-stop guide to Salesforce success. And this is Jarrett411, your up-to-the-minute source on the latest breaking news and developing trends in and beyond the Salesforce ecosystem. From macroeconomic events to implementation questions, legislative changes, and more, our team of experts are here to provide the updates you and your business need to thrive in a constantly evolving industry landscape. If you're anything like the average healthcare provider, your day-to-day is, it's hectic, right? You've been through it a million times. From the moment you walk in until you leave, there are patients in the exam rooms, there are patients in the waiting room, and it's pretty much an endless rinse and repeat cycle. You walk into the room, your patient tells you their immediate issue, you do your best to resolve it, and then you move on. You'd love to go deeper, but you just don't have the time and resources, and there are a lot more people that need your help. Now, that's not to diminish the value you bring in those interactions. Those are potentially life-saving moments, but the thing that's being lost there is the personal connection. Those moments of small talk where you get to know the patient on an individual level. And those conversations, casual though they may be, are honestly really, really important because those are where you often find out the root of a patient's healthcare issues. Talking about work reveals that they've got long hours and a lot of stress. Talking about their home life reveals that they don't live near any grocery stores for healthy food. This is powerful data that can play a monumental role in health outcomes, and I'm talking more than 50% of those outcomes based on research by the Office of Health Policy. But when you're stretched thin and you're dealing with so many patients, there's honestly only so much you can do with that information if you even are able to note it at all. You can put it on a sticky note and slap it in a file, but from there, nothing is getting done with that data. Obviously, providers are doing everything they can with the capacity and resources they have, and addressing the social determinants of health has become a major topic of conversation. But if providers really want to move beyond just talking about the issue, into capturing these softer forms of data and really using them to improve the quality of care for the people that they serve, well, then they need better ways to do it. And that means that they need effective digital tools to make that happen. On this episode of Jarrett 411, we're talking with Jim Rogers, Jarrett's Senior Vice President of Healthcare and Life Sciences, about how Salesforce can help providers meaningfully address the social determinants of health. Jim has legitimately decades of experience working with this topic as a registered nurse for 23 years, with 15 years of experience running healthcare operations and service lines. Jim has an unbelievable depth of insight when it comes to how providers can deliver the best possible care to their patients and how digital tools can help transform the way that that care is delivered. We begin our conversation breaking down the term and really defining what a social determinant of health is and how it can dramatically impact a patient's quality of care. Here's Jim.
So social determinants looks at the non-medical side of healthcare. So what are those things that a person is born with, or a situation that they're born into, or as they live or work or age, that they would come in contact with that would change their health outcomes? So some of it is social, some of it is, you know, where they live. Could be a food desert, something like that, where they don't have access to healthy food. And so you tell someone to eat healthy and they don't have access to it, then it creates a challenge. And so it's really something that we can look at with a population and we can try to solve for those, really at that point, their constituents or clients versus patients. And how can we help them to live the healthiest life that they can live? And what kind of interventions can we make? I think the interesting part from a healthcare perspective, as a registered nurse, we were addressing social determinants before it became a buzzword. So 25 years ago, as a nurse, we did a whole person assessment. So what were the factors besides the clinical factors that were impacting this patient's care in their life? 10 years ago, we were actually addressing what we call barriers to care. So how could we get into the patient's home environment and really assess and understand what were the factors that were contributing to, for example, falls or a lack of proper food and nutrition? So it's interesting that it's come back around as a buzzword, but it's incredibly important that we do address these things in order to improve the health of the communities that we're serving.
Even as providers recognize the crucial importance in identifying social determinants of health among their patients, they still face the unique challenge of collecting this very soft, very interpretive data and then putting it to meaningful use. For more on the unique challenges that this presents to providers in healthcare, let's throw it back to Jim.
I'd sum it up with one word. It's trust. In the patients that we worked with and we were trying to make a difference outside of their primary care office, building a relationship with them, building trust that we're actually there to help them and make things better for them, to get them a better health outcome. That was the biggest challenge. And a lot of times it wasn't just the patient. It was the patient and their caregiver, whether that's a spouse or an adult child or a parent. And oftentimes it was multiple people that we needed to talk with and engage with and build trust. And then, you know, getting into their home environment to understand, we would use our home health agency to do a home safety evaluation where we would come in and see someone that was at risk for falls or had a previous history of falls. Did they have grab bars in their shower? You know, what did their refrigerator look like, right? You know, what was their financial situation? What did they have access to? Did they have a support system around them or not? And so really the biggest part of that was building trust. And then the second piece was, where do you document that, right? Electronic healthcare records are not designed to document social determinants of health. And certainly, you know, Epic and Cerner and other EHRs have made updates in that area. But even 10 years ago, in a lot of EHRs, the phone number field was a text field, and you would get a hint of a barrier to care because you would have a mom's cell and a phone number or husband's cell or something like that. So you're actually entering a caregiver as a text in a phone field. So the biggest challenge is getting to the right folks and then really getting in and understanding what are the challenges that that patient is facing.
Which brings us to the topic of digital tools. By utilizing Salesforce Health Cloud, providers can effectively centralize, distribute, and action key data on a patient at a moment's notice and across every arm of the organization, including key data on a patient's social determinants of health. Here's Jim with a little bit more on how Salesforce can help make that happen.
Data is part of the puzzle. When we're dealing with folks and trying to understand how we can help them live a healthier life, part of it is data around what types of conditions that they have or diseases that they have. But the other part of it is that social side. What kind of situation are they in? So we can map, do they have a transportation issue? Do they have an access to food issue? Do they have an access to care issue? And then the other side of the puzzle is community-based resources and how can we connect those things. And so if we don't collect the data on what we're looking for, we can't match that with the folks who can solve for those issues or challenges. And so that's really putting the whole thing together, is what do we know about this patient and what interventions can we make and how do we bring those two things together and make sure that they happen. And the previous healthcare organizations that I was involved in, we did use Salesforce and used an assessment feature to track that type of information. So we're asking multiple questions. A lot of the answers were set up in such a way that we could run reports and analytics on that, but a lot of them were free text as well. And the most important piece of that was to create an integration to the EHR to get that information in some sort of a narrative format, at least into the patient's record so that it could be shared with the providers. And a lot of times that document or that information would be used with a primary care physician and a nurse to talk about a care plan for that patient. So being able to capture that data, being able to use Marketing Cloud and send messaging to patients, collect bits and pieces of data. You may not collect 35 attributes in a single phone call or a single email, but over the course of a conversation and engaging with that patient, you try to build out that full profile.
Now, when discussing how data can be leveraged to deliver the best care possible to a patient, obviously a provider's internal resources are a key part of that conversation. But they're not the only resources worth considering. Equally important are partner organizations, community nonprofits, and the broader systems of care that providers interact with on an ongoing basis to service the needs of their patients. Now, the challenge there is, how do you ensure that those outside organizations have the same access to data, the same high-quality information, and the same understanding of a patient's social determinants of health as the provider? Here's Jim with how Salesforce can help.
Yeah, it's a challenge. And unlike building out a provider network or a network of facilities and physicians and surgeons and specialists, working with community-based resources can be challenging. You've got to vet those resources to make sure that they're providing quality care. You've got to have a feedback system. It's not enough. And a lot of the 211 systems that are around the country, which is accessing, connecting with these types of community-based resources for patients, really more of a self-service model, and or even in a contact center, they might give them three resources. And then it's good luck, Godspeed, hope it works out, versus I'm sending this person over to you. Here's the things that I want you to do for them. And you're going to report back to me that those things were done. And I'm going to check in with the patient or the caregiver to understand what their experience was like, right? So creating that network is really challenging because you've got to get those pieces. It's got to be a full feedback loop, and you have to do what's in the best interests of the patient throughout that process. And so when building a provider network, healthcare organizations tend to want to own the process. So they would own a skilled nursing facility. They would own a home health agency. They're really not owning all of these different community-based resources. And so pulling those together, it's really a gold mine for a healthcare organization, and being able to get that into the hands of the folks that need it, whether it's a patient directly in a self-service model, or it's with a nurse or a caregiver or a mental health specialist or anybody on the care team that can say, oh, I see a need. Let me create an intervention. Let me follow up and make sure that that intervention happened and that we are closing the loop or doing the best we can to address that barrier to care.
So you're a provider. You've got your plan laid out. You've got your digital tools in place. You've worked with your outside organizations, but there's still one big question to face. As you start to collect this data on social determinants of health, how do you make sure that the information coming in is accurate, is high quality, and is giving your team the clearest possible picture of the patients that they serve? And as Jim points out here, the assessment of that information needs to happen much earlier than you think.
The assessment actually starts before you begin the program, right? You've got to understand your patient population, which is unique across the country and even across a same city from different organizations, right? What does your patient population look like? What kind of assessments have you done on those patients? What barriers to care have you identified? Is it transportation? Do they have safety and security issues? Do they have nutritional issues? What are the challenges? Is it an education issue? Access to medications? Whatever that is, then you design your program around that. And you're looking at a geographic network, right? Where do we need to have these types of resources? And then you're looking at a service line or a resource network. Right? Where are we missing resources? And once you develop that network, and you can use heat maps and things like that to create that tableau to look at the analytics of it and dive in. And once you've created that, now you can start engaging with your patients and creating these interventions and tracking the success of the intervention and looking at the outcome. For example, if you're trying to get a lower cost option for insulin to diabetics, what did their blood sugars look like before or after you started this program? What did their number of visits to an emergency department look like before or after? So you start measuring the healthcare outcome, but you're also looking at, you know, did they follow through with the intervention? Were they able to get the transportation? Did the transportation show up? Whatever the issue is, how did we perform with the network that we've created? What gaps did we find in our network, whether it's resource-based or geographic? And then how do we address those individual things? And Salesforce is a great tool to be able to do that. And I don't think we can discount the impact of virtual care, right? Getting mental health professionals into rural areas or into even urban areas, it can be a challenge, but that's one thing that can be addressed virtually. And there are certainly virtual types of visits that would negate the need for having a clinic or physical location where the patient's located, or providing transportation for that patient. Amazon, you know, has the opportunity to really change the way we engage with patients by delivering goods and services, you know, in a short amount of time, 12 hours, 24 hours. Sometimes it's within an hour in some of the urban areas, inner city. And that's a huge opportunity to leverage these community-based resources to send those things to them. But also foundations can get involved and send those things as well, right? So it doesn't have to be giving somebody money, or it doesn't have to be sending somebody physically to them, but they can share resources with them in a much easier fashion.
No one person exists in a vacuum. The contexts of a patient's life, their unique experiences and environment, these things do so much to inform the challenges they face, the potential complications that could arise in delivering them care, and the keys to ensure that they get the best experience possible with every interaction. That's why it's so important for providers to have the right tools on hand that allow for them to collect and understand as much data on social determinants of health as possible. Because in many cases, they provide the missing puzzle piece to a patient's diagnosis that allows for meaningful treatment to occur. And at the end of the day, it's just about seeing patients as the people that they are, not just one-and-done diagnoses. This has been Transformation at Work. Thank you again for listening, and thank you again to Jim for some truly incredible insights during our conversation. Transformation at Work is, as always, produced by Jarrett in collaboration with Salesforce. I am Jeff Stormer, your host and producer. If you enjoyed the show, consider leaving us a 5-star review on iTunes or Spotify, or head to Jarrett.com to sign up for email updates when we release new episodes. Until next time, thank you again for listening, and we hope to see you again soon.